Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming tonight. My name is David Allen. I'm the Deputy City Manager, and we are here to do our next some visioning and form-based code preparation for the next two areas. As you're all aware, we completed a project of this nature for the Central Business District, the downtown area, and this will be our next phase. We're going to be doing the North End and Islington Street. And so tonight, we're having this kickoff meeting, and we have with us Brian Wright from Town Planning and Urban Design Collaborative, who was our consultant on the last project and will be the consultant for these next two phases. Also with us tonight, we have the mayor, Bob Lister, we have Councillor Splaine, Councillor Dwyer, Councillor Lowne, and Councillor Morgan. I think that's it for our city councillors. Our city manager, John Bohenko, and from staff, we have the planning director just back from Holland, Rick Tainter, and Nick Cracknell, the chief planner. Also, we have from planning staff, we have Beth Moreau, and any other planning board members? No. So with that, what we're going to do tonight is Brian is going to go through the process, kind of talk about what you're going to be going through on November 10th through 13th. We're going to have an intensive 4-day charrette that Brian's group will be heading, and I think most of you, or a lot of you, were involved in a similar exercise that we had 2 years ago on Market Square Day for 4 days. So with that, I'm going to turn that over to Brian. He's going to talk about the process. Once he's gone through his presentation, we're going to open it up for question and answers, and so we can kick this thing off. Thank you.
Thanks. I got my own mic. Can you guys hear me? Okay, great. All right, so it's great to be back and see familiar faces, and you know, a lot of times we work in a city, and you know, we've solved all their problems, so they don't have to have us come back again, and so we don't ever see them, and we kind of miss them. So I'm glad to be back with you guys. I just finished a charrette in Yarmouth, Maine last night, and so I got a little sleep, so I'm okay. So don't worry. But it's again with Yarmouth, they were repeat customers as well, so I'm feeling kind of a homey thing going on, so I like this. So what I'm going to do is go through the presentation pretty quickly and just kind of let you guys know what's coming and what to expect, and you know, as always, get to the end so that you guys can ask questions and give comments and move forward. So what we're doing is we're extending the amending the form-based code to add other areas that people, when we were here, how long ago has it been now? A year ago? A year. So when we were here a year ago, people were saying, well, why is this area and that area not included? And it's like, oh, okay, we hear you. So now it's been added. So now we're going through this process. So what we're doing from the form-based coding perspective has a few different key components. One of the things is protecting what you guys love the most, right? And so, you know, we've learned through working here with you guys that you're very, very passionate and protective of this place, and rightly so. It's one of our favorite cities in the country, and we work all over from coast to coast. It's just really amazing. As we drove in a minute ago, we were just thinking, wow, we forget how much we love it here. So we're going to protect. And then another thing is to ensure that redevelopment of available properties is, you know, really supporting and strengthening more of what you love. And so, you know, as development proposals come forward, you know, people say, you know, they have different concerns about things. Sometimes they say they love it, sometimes they're concerned. And so thinking about making sure that redevelopment is in keeping with what you're looking for in the future. And then the last thing is maintaining and expanding on the unique qualities that are this place. What, you know, really to think about it as the authenticity of this place. And it's really hard. You know, most zoning ordinances aren't set up to think about authenticity at all. It's really, you know, some pretty simple standards and metrics that, you know, people can use. And so one of the beauties of the form-based code approach is that while it doesn't explicitly say you must incorporate authenticity in any new development, it really is embedded within it as we go through that process. And you guys help us know, as the outsiders, you know, what it is that you think is unique. So if you haven't seen it before, you know, this is the the Planned Portsmouth form-based code cover, and it's got a lot of great things in it. It's been adopted and is, you know, ready for development. This project, though, it's kind of broken into two areas. We have North End and the Islington Street Corridor, and we're going to, while this is a one kickoff meeting to talk about both of them, we're actually going to do a separate process for each of them. So each will have their own charrette. Because, you know, while they're not geographically, you know, very far apart, there are specific concerns related to each one. And so it seemed like it made some sense to break them into two pieces, so it's a little bit easier to focus and digest all of the issues. So one of the things that's a little bit different this time than last time is we're going to be focusing also on visioning and planning rather than just focusing on the coding so much. When you're looking at the downtown, you know, it's not as necessary important to think about, you know, big picture, what can happen. It's, you know, it's pretty, you know, there's a lot here that might be available to redevelop at some point. There's a lot there. But when you're looking at some of the other areas of the city, then you end up having, you know, opportunities for, you know, larger scale development. Larger lots are available and those sorts of things. And so we want to, you know, really make sure that everybody understands that there's visioning going on too. And so as we're talking about this, it's not just, you know, hey, when new development happens, what might its character ought to be like? It's really like, hey, where do you guys think new development could happen? And what are some ideas that we have about new development as well? And let's draw that. And then it also, as we're drawing it, we're drawing things that are possible and, you know, available and allowed from a character or form-based code perspective. And then we can actually discuss it in a really more meaningful way. It's like you actually say, oh, well, if you do these things, here's what it might look like on a plane, and here's a rendering of that. And so you can have a deeper discussion. And so just to kind of explain what I mean a little bit, this is from the closing presentation I did last night in Maine, and where this is the town of Yarmouth here. And we were looking at their waterfront. They have a little harbor here, and it's really disconnected from the town. And the black buildings we're showing here are conceived, proposed, you know, ideas where they could do new development to start to infill their harbor and make it more pedestrian-friendly, more of a place where they could go down and enjoy the waterfront instead of it just being completely, you know, water, boating and water-oriented right now. And so we said, okay, here's some ideas for some plans. It doesn't have to be just like this. You know, the property owner was there, but they didn't say, do this on my property, do that. We just took liberties. They don't have to go do this, but they could go do this once the character-based code is enacted. And so then we showed them, here's existing condition, and then here is how it might start to develop in the future and become this really interesting and, you know, sort of special place, infused with the character that the citizens told us they were looking for. Another example, this is their the intersection of their main street, and their train tracks come through here. There's a train depot, and they were thinking about commuter rail coming in the future. And so they said, if it does come in, how can we make sure that we have transit-oriented development that's supportive of that? Because it may not, so we need to make sure. And what will that look like? And so we showed them the black buildings are, again, new buildings and creating these really interesting spaces. And the pink buildings are existing. And we showed them, you know, how to deal with parking and all those kinds of things. And one of the big offenders, apparently, in town was this Dunkin' Donuts. Everybody in town hated it. It set back. With a parking lot in front and kind of this conventional suburban way where the rest of Main Street is this beautiful historic houses that have been converted into shops and some, you know, mixed use and those kind of things. So we said, okay, Dunkin' Donuts, we know you all don't like it. Here's what it could happen, what could happen there, and now here's Dunkin' Donuts. And then, of course, they all cheered, you know, they thought it was great. And so this was a visioning exercise. And then here's the downtown. I showed you the train depot. This is a lumber yard existing right now. They have this sort of sad little common, town common that's really not used. And so we showed them what they could do if they cleaned up some of the junkyard and infilled some of these areas where they have big parking lots out in front on their main street. And here's the depot now. And here is an amazing proper civic space where the town could actually gather. And they might have, you know, their clam fest that they have every year, you know, could be centered on this town common. And so everybody got really excited about that. So you'll be seeing some of this during this process as well to help you guys visualize and think about what you might like to see and give the property owner some ideas. But the real focus of the project is the zoning. And so, of course, you know, we start with your existing zoning and then I lose my slides, and wow, what happened? I bet it'll pop up in a second. There we go. It always does that to me, just to freak me out. So we start with the existing zoning and start to understand what that means, what the rights are that people currently have, and you know what that can look like. And so then we'll go on to look in the field and start to assess the, oh wow, the whole thing just froze. It tricked me. So then we'll go out in the field and do what we call synoptic surveys. And we'll actually go out and measure, and we'll start to focus on what the existing condition is, what the DNA is. And for those who were involved in the last charrette, you saw how we did that. And, you know, instead of just saying, we think it should be like this, we say, you know, here's the zoning says this because we saw out in the field that the setbacks are like this, the building heights are like that, and it's really important and for everything to be situated together. Now, this is a trick. I have a really bad memory. That's why I count on my slides. So this will, there we go. Now I have nothing to show you. So how many of you guys were involved in the last process, in the last charrette? We have any? Oh, that's great, a lot of first-timers. So what we'll do is the charrette process is set up so that it's very interactive. The idea is for everybody to, you know, feel heard and to participate in the process. What we do is we'll actually bring my team to town and set up our office. And then we'll go through the process. We'll, as we're, you know, the whole process is open. We'll have kickoff presentations where we won't have technical difficulties. And we'll all stand around and sit around and talk and listen to the ideas that you guys have for the future. And then we'll have breakout meetings with specific topics. And those meetings will be set up so that, you know, we know some people aren't comfortable talking in front of a large group. And so we'll break them out, and then we'll go through, we'll have a pin-up about halfway through. We say, okay, here's what we've heard so far. What do you guys think about that? How are we doing? Are we getting it right? Are we able to continue on this path, or do we need to adjust course? And then we will take that feedback, and my team is working all the time. So I'm standing up, usually I'm standing, not squatting, standing up giving presentations, and then we'll, my team's drawing and working and writing the code and doing all of those sorts of things as part of the process, and we will be able to advance slides now. Yes! Oh, man. All right. That's like a presenter's nightmare. I don't know if you guys have to stand up and talk to people in front of people a lot, but that's like the worst thing that ever happened. So, and that may be one of the worst times that's ever happened to me. So what we'll do is, good thing you guys already know me, most of you, so we will get right to it and see what I forgot. Whoa, I was right on track. So the charrette process, how about that? So here's what it looks like when you have meetings with lots of people, if you've not seen those before. Here's the team set up. Our office, this was an empty abandoned pool hall before we came to town. This was in Indiana. And you know, we'll do these breakout exercises after the opening presentation where we'll have you guys be planners for the night, and you'll get your markers and your dots, and you'll mark up the maps, and you'll say, oh, you know, over here is an opportunity for something new to happen. Over here, these are the things that we love the most in the area, and we don't want it to change. We want it to stay like that and have more of that. And then these are areas that we really don't like. And so you'll see the dots and the marks on the map representing that. We'll do lots of this, which I sometimes have to teach people about. This is called listening. And so we'll listen to each other. Hopefully you won't have to listen to me too much. I'll be listening to you guys mostly. And then this is, again, one of the distinctions. There will be planning and drawing happening while we're here. We'll be, you know, starting to help you guys articulate and crystallize that vision and put it on paper, what you share with us. And then we'll have, you know, those kind of presentations as well. So I'll give you a little bit of a form-based code 101 for those of you who are new to the form-based code concept. So the way that we think about coding in a form-based approach is that, unlike most coding, where use is the first most important thing, it's, you know, separate this from that is kind of the way most zoning works. Here we think about, you know, what is, based on the studies that we've done, what is the essence of this place and how do we infuse that into a code? And there's kind of two different ways we think about it. We think about the private frontage, the private realm, that's the sort of the public lot up to the right-of-way, and then everything between the right-of-ways is the public realm, the public frontage. And so this is controlled by the people who own the property. They build things on their property. They do things with that property. And this is controlled by the city. And so this is what that looks like in real life. So here, there's not as clear of a distinction between the private and the public because it's a zero setback. And so it's right up against the property line. But you know that this is public and this is private. So that's how we think about it. This is from your existing form-based code. And so these are a couple of pages here. So each of the different zones, the character zones, they're set up to focus on these different ideas of the essence of it here. And so you can see on the images on the left-hand side of the page, these are the sort of the vision, the inspiration for people who are doing things with their property. And then on the right-hand side, it's much more technical. And each zone has its own page. And so it's from more urban to less urban is the way it's set up. And so you'll see, you know, you have a description here in the picture to show you what it's all about. And it's really easy in a place like this because you just go look around and say more of this. In some places we work, we actually have to go elsewhere in other towns and cities nearby because they say, we don't really have anything we love here. And so can you bring us something good? And so we do that. Here is really the technical side of things. And so each of these letters represents a specific metric. So setbacks and building heights and building uses. Uses are still in there, even though we're talking about form primarily. Use is just not the most important thing. It's like the sixth most important thing. We talk about civic spaces, particular types of civic spaces, not just, you know, leftover, you know, whatever's left around. We say, you know, each of the different character zones has specific civic spaces that are allowed in it. And then when we're in the private realm, we have these different frontage types. And so here we're talking about the common yard, and so the blue areas are the frontages. So, and this is what that looks like in real life in town here. And porches, you know what porches look like. Steps, this is actually a new one. We didn't used to do this until we came to work here before, because you guys have a lot of interesting examples of this where it just comes kind of right onto the sidewalk with one step or two steps or. But there's no actual stoop, which is what most places do. You guys are, so historic. You're a little bit before stoops in some areas. So you're pre-stoop. But there are some stoops around, so we accommodate for those as well. We've got shop fronts here. You have a million examples of amazing shop fronts and office fronts, and that's really where then there's not necessarily a shop front per se. It's clearly an office building. And then forecourts is kind of set back in there as well. Here there are different building types that are allowed in different zones. So you have houses and duplexes and row houses and live-work buildings and small commercial buildings and apartment buildings and large commercial buildings as well. And so these are all in your existing form-based code. And so here's what that starts to look like on an actual block of real things. So you can start to kind of bring it down to the street level. So here's different building types. So there's one of these live works. There's a duplex there. There's different, we talk about glazing percentage. How much glass is on the front of a building is one of the things that we would control in the form-based code. And so that's how we start to think about and calculate glazing. The frontage types are shown here. The setbacks, you know, sometimes they're very small. Sometimes they're larger depending on which character zone. And how you calculate building height, looking at number of stories. And then this was an example of, this is a lot that's sort of set back and there's not much going on there. And so for illustrative purposes, we did this drawing, and the drawing got rid of this nice little tree, but you could imagine the tree could stay on the corner here. And so you start to see how that might infill, similar to the Dunkin' Donuts. And then again, breaking it down, here's the setbacks, here's the building types, broken down. Here's the number of stories, the frontage types, and the glazing percentages. So that's a really, really quick version of, you know, what's the form-based code all about. But what I want to do now is really kind of start to hear from you guys about, you know, do you have any questions about the, you know, planning or the charrette process? I didn't say much about the form-based code. You know, do you have questions about that? And then we can also, after that, you know, really talk about what are some of your visions or concerns for the future of the area, and really just kind of give me a preview of what we're going to hear more about when we start our charrette process. So as, you know, I'm working on presentations and stuff, I can start to tailor it more towards the things that you guys are interested in hearing in the future. So apologize for the technical difficulties. That's not a good way to start a meeting, but you guys want to chat for a little while?
So if there are questions, we're going to have, Nick is going to bring the mic around so this is being recorded.
Simple question. What are the hours for the charrette so we can calendar those times?
Yes. So the, well, all I know are the dates, the 10th through the 13th. The hours are as long as we need to be there to get the work done. So what you'll find is, you know, we know that not everybody is able to come to every meeting that's scheduled. And so that's why we have our open studio. And so, you know, the doors will be open. If the lights are on, you're welcome to come in. Sometimes, you know, when we're working in a place like Burlington, Vermont, you know, College Town, it's 2 a.m. and college students are trickling by on Church Street and they, you know, want to talk at 2 a.m. Sometimes we're there. Hopefully not. I'm getting older. But, you know.
Well, Brian, I think we can add to that. We'll put together an agenda. We'll work with you over the next couple of weeks to put together an agenda for the charrettes with some times so it's clear where we're going to be. I think we're at the middle school at the new Connie Bean is where it'll be located, but we will put together an agenda with some time slots so people know when they can plug in.
We always make sure they give us a key, though, so we can get in when we need to.
More questions?
This is really a question, but let me preface it this way. I'm 67 years old, and I'm pleased about that because I'm a survivor, but it also means I've only got maybe 5 or 10 more good years in Portsmouth. Maybe a little longer, maybe who knows what happens tomorrow. But the point is, as I look in this audience, I notice some good diversity of ages. I don't know, quite a few of us are 40-ish and over. And they may have, you may have about 30 years to go. My point is, have you worked before at trying to generate, and I think that we could do this if we did some outreach, especially if it's at the middle school, really younger people. The high school, it seems to me that we could have, Bob Lister could help on this, our mayor, because of his background. It seems to me that we could really involve some younger people. I mean, really young people. And at the middle school, I mean, I'd like to see their kind of visions for this area that we're talking about. And who knows what they might come up with. It might be the best of all.
Yeah.
Have you done that before?
Yes, we have.
How's it worked?
It works well. You know, we've actually done a sort of a mini charrette for kids, for little kids. And so it involves sitting on the floor, you know, with them rather than at tables and stuff. It's great. It works well, and they have a good time, especially these days, you know, all the different games and stuff they're making, cities and things, and so they are already thinking about those kinds of things. What we like to do is, you know, back to Yarmouth where we just were, I mean, they have their population is really aging, and they haven't been bringing in young families to kind of, you know, replace the ones that used to be young families. Part of the problem, you know, is the fact that the housing prices are really expensive there, but we also found that the people who have enjoyed living there for their whole life, you know, they have these, you know, sort of 3,000 square foot amazing historic mansions, and they're too big for them. They don't want to deal with the lawn, all of these things, and so they're looking now to move, you know, kind of into some of the stuff that I showed you, like into the village, into the heart there, but there aren't those types of opportunities for them to have a condo or something like that. And so what we like to do is really think about, you know, a plan and a vision for the future that is multi-generational, and it allows people to age in place, because right now the people in Yarmouth have to leave town when they can no longer stay in their house or they can't drive. And we know that people can walk nearly 20 years longer than they can drive for the most part. And so making sure that sort of everybody's embraced in the process is important. I think that it's hard. When we're working in New Hampshire, we're in this town, and people literally didn't go vote because they were at Little League games. They were so strapped, you know, so stretched thin with the kids' stuff. It's hard sometimes to get the families in, and so we have to sort of make it explicitly, you know, kid-friendly and fun. And you know, we did it in Yarmouth. We had a chili fest one night. We had a pie social the first kickoff. You know, there are things you can do to get people to come and participate and really sort of increase the diversity of the group. So that's good to know that that's something that you guys are interested in. So we can think through that with the planning department, see how we can bring some more people in.
So in talking about coming to these types of meetings, I've found that a lot of people don't believe that they actually have a voice in the planning. What suggestions would you give to convincing townspeople that they, if they want to see something that they want rather than complaining about it, that these meetings actually work and they will have a say?
By these meetings, do you mean planning meetings or TPDC charrette meetings?
Charrette meetings.
I mean, the ones that we do?
Yeah. So what happens in those meetings? What the people say actually get in there? Or is it just a select group of people that get?
The hardest part is getting the people to come, you know. Once you get them there, and those of you who participated in the past, I think, you know, one of the things we're known for is, I mean, people literally come up to me at the end, so tearfully say, you know, you listened, you really listened. You know, I saw my ideas contained within there, you know. And so it's something that we focus on particularly. And so if you guys can help us get people there, I'll take care of the rest. But it's super fun. It's, you know, the process is set up to be interactive and engaging and you know, to really, we dig hard, you know, we want to know, you know, because I don't know. I mean, when I walked in here, thankfully, Nick kept me from looking like an idiot. I had Islington Street and North End swapped on the pictures. You know, I don't have any preconceived notions of what this place is. I'm not from here. Even though we worked here a lot, we worked in other parts of the city. And so it's super important for all of you guys and all everybody at home, wherever the camera is, to come and participate in this process, and it'll be worth your while.
My next question is, once you've done these charrettes and you've had everything drawn out and all the ideas and the listening, what's the next step? What is the final plan? Does it match what everyone came up with, or how close is it?
Yeah. So there's always somebody who wants the Space Needle that didn't get it, and they're always sad about that, you know? But for the most part, what we find is no one's really going away concerned that their ideas weren't there. You know, I mean, there are specific things, like when we're in Texas and they want an outdoor ice skating rink, doesn't work that well, you know. And so I nicely explained to them why we didn't include it, but that other thing you wanted is right over there. Oh yeah, that's great. And then they forget the thing they didn't want, that they want, you know. And so the plan will, the kind of the process is, you know, this open charrette concept, you know, for the longest time there wasn't really an opportunity for communities to be involved, and now it's a much more democratic process. Everybody comes and gives their ideas. It's expected now, you know, around the country that you'll do these things. It didn't used to be the case. And so the thing that's nice about it is it's in addition to your normal process. And so once we do the plan and draft the code, the code will have to go through the normal process of adoption and being vetted and having public meetings and all of those kind of things. And so we really say the end of the charrette is the beginning of the process. And so hopefully the beauty of the charrette process is that people aren't having to come and take a reactive approach to it. They've been proactively involved from the beginning and can feel good about what's in there. So kind of the way it works.
Yeah. Right here.
Oh, microphone.
As you make the preparations for this process, is there the possibility to get together with the Historical Society and perhaps the planning department here in the city to go and retrieve some photographs at the very least, perhaps some area maps of the whole North End as to what was there previous to the urban renewal and the demolition of a lot of the historical buildings, so that folks will have some retrospective, historically speaking, as far as what they might be able to visualize looking forward to offer something reminiscent as to some of the beauty that was lost in that neighborhood, so we can sort of reclaim some of our heritage and our history as we go forward with some of the new planning and the modernization and all that other good stuff.
Yeah, I would love that. I collect historic maps and aerial photographs, so I'm a bit of a history buff, and I sometimes I feel like when we start a project, especially in a historic place, that I'm a bit of an urban archaeologist, and I'm kind of like, I like to look backwards to start to see forward, because they did things so well. You know, in some places we have to look really hard. You guys have done a great job for the most part of keeping stuff intact. But I would love to see all that and start to incorporate it, because I mean, there are specific examples. I remember we were working outside of Atlanta, Georgia, in Monroe, and they had this, I found the old Sanborn maps, and I was able to dig through, and I looked at them over the years, and I started to see how the main street evolved. And there was this little way that went through called Palmer's Alley. And over the years, they had actually added onto the buildings around Palmer's Alley, and it had filled in, and it was lost. And I realized as I went down Main Street, there was this little one-story, poorly constructed, out-of-character building that had a furniture store, and it was really skinny and long. And I realized that was Palmer's Alley. And we looked at it, and so we did this really cool drawing to show, like, if you could take it and reclaim it, pull it back out, and it became this amazing space in the middle of the block, like some of the ones you guys have around here. And so I love that stuff. I got to tour the Athenaeum when I was here last time, and I went in there and got in the big book room, and I looked at your Sanborn maps, and I was so impressed you guys still have the covers on them. Most of the people have lost their covers, and so long story short, I'd love to do that. So.
More questions?
Hi, just a comment. Is it possible to host one of the charrettes at New Franklin School, which is a neighborhood school for the North End, one of them? We've had several neighborhood meetings there, and it attracts a lot of young people.
Yeah. So the process is that when we get there, when we, you know, the charrette is the multiple day thing, and when we get there, we sort of set up shop. And, you know, usually it's, you know, the town has figured out where's the best places, or the city has figured out the best place for us to be. And so I'll leave that up to all you guys to figure out the logistics of it. But, you know, whatever makes the most sense is what we do, is our general philosophy.
Yep. You talked about both character-based codes and form-based codes. Are they two words for the same thing, or two different things?
Same thing. Thank you. Okay. In some places we go, we talk about it from a character-based perspective. I mean, it's all about character, but some communities it's just simpler to say character because people get that. But you guys have gone through the whole form-based process, and everybody understands that here, so we're sticking with it. So you have your character districts here.
Anything else?
I know that you have an awful lot of experience with form-based zoning, obviously, having attended all the previous meetings. Will you be coming with ideas of your own based on your previous experience as to what might, things that might enhance the area that we're talking about here?
The first thing I have to do is understand the area, and we try not to do it until we get here, because what I found is when I look from afar, and, you know, look, study the aerial photo. I mean, these days it's pretty awesome. You can get on Google Street View and see stuff you couldn't see before without being there. But even, you know, with all the technology I have, I find that when we start to dig too deeply in advance, we start to make assumptions that are often wrong. We have preconceived ideas. And when we're doing such an open and transparent process and trying to involve the public in such a way, I find that people really appreciate me coming kind of as a blank canvas. We'll bring ideas that we've seen all in our work all around the country and those sort of things. And once we understand what the issues are, what the, you know, the places are like and all of that kind of stuff, then we'll be able to say, you know what? What if you guys, you know, consider? Have you thought about this? Most of the time, though, there's only like a couple of those things that we generate. Most of the stuff just comes from the citizens, and we're able to take what a citizen said, in one way, and help kind of say, oh wow, that's great. Let me build on that. And so, most of the ideas that you'll see will be from the citizens, but we'll certainly bring, hopefully some new ideas to you guys, so it's worth your while having us here. But it's all, it's about you guys, You're the experts of this place.
Got the mic.
Oh, yeah, sorry.
And while a diverse demographic is what we're looking for in this room tonight and at the Charettes in the future, we're talking about younger groups and ages being involved too. Mostly I've heard so far elementary-based ages, but also high school, maybe mid-20s, early 20s, late 20s. We know a lot of these people are getting a hold of each other on social networks. Do you guys have a base on the internet to reach out to these people, people my age? I actually heard about this from my dad today, and I'm pretty involved in the local downtown scene, and around the different establishments here. But I haven't seen much about this, and haven't heard much buzz amongst people my age yet. So how could I entice more people to come to the Charette in November? That's one question that I have. Sorry, I have one more. The other is, while we're also looking deeply into the form and character and that appeal, I imagine that the conversation is also about the functionality as well. How much are we focused not only about looking charming and having the characteristic of the past, but being focused on technologies of the future that are going to make the city more sustainable and livable and so on?
Yeah, that's great. Those are two great questions. As I said, I have a bad memory, so I'll try to remember them both as I answer them. But the first thing, I can't remember, how do we do social media last time? We did Twitter, and then there was stuff on the town Facebook page, city Facebook page. For me, what I would say is, we're all about that. I mean, as much as is appropriate and is, usual here in the city, to do that, what we'll do is, make sure these guys have what they need to be able to blast it out there. But honestly, I mean, I'm glad you're here, because I'll say to you, it starts with you. Let's crowdsource, and you're the first one. You're the red dot, and let's go.
Do you have an official Facebook page?
Yeah, my firm has one. Yeah, so you can go there, and we'll put stuff on there as well. And if the city's not doing that, then we'll try to do a better job on ours of keeping up with this project specifically, and do that. So, but I think all the things that you just said, tying the technology in and kind of making not only a visionary plan but a practical plan, but practical and not in the boring way, is important, because when you're looking at a historic place like this, you got character in spades here, but it's really a challenge to do stuff sometimes because of infrastructure and just kind of, you guys are really tight and everything's kind of packed in here because people just we're trying to densify over the years, and it made an amazing place, but it brought challenges with it. They didn't have to worry about cars and all those kinds of things. And so as we're working on the planning, I always say we take the best of the old and bring the best of the new, and those two things come together. It's awesome. It's where people want to be. But can I count on you to be our liaison to the cool young people? All right, cool. Yeah.
Question actually for Rick and Nick, maybe. But about 6 years ago, I participated in some visioning for the Islington Corridor project. So I'm just wondering what relations all of that work is going to have to the Charette for Islington.
Sure. That was primarily focused on the streetscape aspects of Islington Street and the Islington Street corridor. So that's still in place, and that will be fed in. That'll be part of the basic information that gets given to the consultants for this. But the work that they're working on is more on the private sector and the zoning aspects and how we regulate development. So those two should complement each other. Anybody else?
There's one back there. We'll get you.
As I listen to this, I'm trying to motivate myself to really get into this. I hate to waste my time, and I hate to see everybody else's time get wasted. So I'm trying to get a clear definition of, or pathway. We meet here, we go to the charrettes, they report it to the town. You got HGC, you got planning, you've got TAC, and all the other things. This thing keeps going around in my mind. Is this the powers that be that will just say, well, we'll get to it when we get to it. We placated the people in general, they've had their say, and now we'll go on to do pretty much what we think is the right thing for the town, and we've wasted our time. What I'm asking is, if you expect me and other people to come to these meetings, what hope can you give us that our voice will actually be heard and that we're not just screaming at a wall?
Yeah, well, my goal is that through this process there will be no screaming. And I promise I won't be a wall if you promise you won't scream. So the one thing that I can say is it's amazing here, because you guys have already done it once and you did it pretty quickly. You know, it was pretty, you know, it was like we did the charrette, we went through the process, the code was adopted, boom, here you go, now you're ready. And so this process being focused on the coding components of it and expanding that, I have no reason to think that it wouldn't move forward in the same way. The open process means that if I don't do what I say that I'm going to do, you guys are right there to hold me accountable and say, that plan doesn't look anything at all like what we just told you. What are you talking about? And then everybody who brought me here, my team here, is also on the spot. And so I think that I know day one, I'm saying, hey, I'm Brian, nice to meet you, trust me. But in the end, I think through this process, you'll see that it will be worth your while. And I don't know that, you know, there's any reason to not move forward. I mean, for heaven's sakes, how long have you guys been meeting about these areas? How many times have people been, you know, upset or concerned?
She just said 7 years ago.
Yeah, well, streetscapes, you know, aren't too... Yeah. So, you know, I think that after you've gone through this, as long as you have, I think the idea is, you know, a lot of times our projects are set up like this to be kind of the finish line. It's like, all right, enough is enough. Let's quit having to haggle over each thing. Let's all come together in a real way and set the rules, set the standards, set the vision. Done. Now we've all agreed. Now we don't have to struggle with it anymore. And once we've all agreed, let's agree that we're not going to struggle anymore. Because a lot of times what you'll see is, you know, people participate, go through a process, the zoning's in place, their voice was heard and even reflected, and they still come to complain, you know. So maybe we'll just make a compact here all together. We'll make an agreement and say that, you know, if you participate, you know, and it moves forward in the way that you're happy with, you guys are all going to be on board, and we don't have to keep coming around and around and around. This will last us into the future. So. I can't give you many more assurances than that. Now we got one over here.
Just to make another point on that, we have five members of the city council here. The whole process does, like Brian said, it begins with these meetings. Then it goes, there's a public process going through the planning board, which then goes on to the city council. At each of those levels, there are public hearings. So obviously when we have five city councilors at a meeting, they're obviously interested. They're the policy directors for the city. So this is obviously something that's important to the city, and it's important to staff. So, you know, I think the proof is in the pudding as to who you see here and that this is important, and there will be follow through on this.
Can you go in the back there? He's been raising his hand patiently for a while.
I wondered about the boundaries for these districts. I haven't actually looked very closely at the map, but I wonder how the boundaries were set, and Can they, is it flexible, or are you just being paid for the areas within the boundaries? For instance, I wonder if, like, the Frank Jones property, which is being discussed a lot now, very big parcel, sort of near Islington Street, if that's included in your study area.
Yeah. So we get paid by the block. No, I'm just kidding. there is some, you know, kind of rationale, because the, you know, when you move from one area to the next, sometimes, like, for instance, you know, we were, we're kind of right over here near the industrial stuff, right? Once you include that, that's a whole nother, you know, kind of character and those sorts of things. As we were sort of figuring out the boundaries together, there were some kind of, this makes sense to go in, this makes sense to leave out. But what we find too is that a lot of times, you know, the lines on a map sometimes don't reflect the reality when you get out there. And so you say, oh, wow, you know, if we went, you know, two lots further down the street, it actually has the same character, and that maybe should come in, you know. So there, you know, it's not locked in stone per se, but I'd say, you know, I feel pretty good about it. I know that these guys have spent a lot of time looking at the boundaries and all that. So, hey, Claire.
Sorry. We also made adjustments when we did the last charrette with the downtown, and I think we started with about 80 acres and ended with 100. And so it is somewhat fluid, obviously within limits, and I think Brian's right. It's the scope, budget, as well as the context that really sets the initial boundaries. Thank you.
One concern some people have is that, one question is, how many acres are you actually going to have to design, because there are a number of enormous projects going up in the North End right now, and they're hurtling through the approval process, which is sped up by something called design review, by which the minute a developer files some kind of paper, it's esteemed that they're already in under the last zoning. So,
yeah.
And so far, the lots are huge, and I think buildings are allowed to cover 95% of them, and efforts to reduce that have not succeeded.
Yeah, well, so one thing I would say along those lines is, first, I don't know, is the first answer. The second thing is, to your point, I think there's some motivation to actually move things along from the citizen standpoint. A lot of times what we find is, a code process, the thing that takes the longest is, you know, kind of the citizen input, you know, and the helping, getting the citizens through the process and helping them feel, you know, like it's okay and all of that. And so you guys can actually make it go faster once it gets in the process by coming and supporting, assuming you agree with it and like it. We'll see.
I would just add, in terms of the North End, that area that's shown in blue on the map is about 40 acres. And if you look at what's out there and what's either been approved under construction or even pending approval, I don't think anything up there is under design review at this time. They're all in the permitting process with the Historic Commission or the Planning Board under a full-blown site plan approval. I think if you look at the real estate that's out there, somewhere between 40 and 50% of the property that's designated as the North End there is still potentially redevelopable in the next 10 to 20 years. So it's not currently under construction or pending review. There's still a lot of real estate with some buildings that are either non-contributing or intrusive from a historic preservation standpoint, or there's parking lots that are out there still in the North End. So there's a lot of work, there's a lot of opportunity, there's still a significant threat, depending on how you look at it, if we sit on our hands and continue to go forward with what we have for existing zoning. So I certainly think it's well worth looking at it and realizing it's more than a couple of properties that are left available in the North End. And if you look at Islington Street, there's clearly a lot more potential with the Frank Jones area off Kate Street. You've got the Button Factory, which is thriving and exciting, but it's a very big set of properties down that side of Islington Street. And clearly, when you go across the road and look at the brewery, there's tremendous redevelopment potential that's still there. So it's really, and then you have the whole corridor of Islington Street from the 51 Islington Street project around the Discover Portsmouth Center all the way down to Bartlett Street. So there's a lot that can happen there, and certainly not all of it will be replaced or should be. But we need to take a serious look at it and go through the process here. I want to get to you. Thanks for being patient.
Actually, Claire stole my thunder. I was gonna ask about the challenges of working in a district where so many lots are already permitted and and under review, and how I don't have a good sense of the time that this process will take. And you know, certainly some projects are going to be far beyond the purview of the process that's starting here.
Yeah.
So how do you deal with that sort of with that complexity still having an impact on a neighborhood or an area in the city that's really going to be under construction by the time this sees its way through this process and then the city boards?
Yeah, the way we think about it is, in a lot of ways, it's while it was so close, it becomes an existing condition. It's just like when we're working in downtown, and when you look at downtown, talk about where are you going to do new stuff, where are you going to do new development. We see it in the same way, but what we find is sometimes if the developer or landowner is really paying attention and has participated in the process, even those who aren't too far along sometimes say, you know what, this whole form-based thing actually sounds pretty cool, and I may be able to do something better or different than I was thinking about doing. Maybe I'll just take my time and get in on that instead of hurrying through with this other thing. It doesn't always happen, but sometimes. One thing you could do is encourage them to come participate, and maybe they'll be excited about some of these ideas, and maybe not. Nick, we got one up front here. Oh, Mike's back there.
I'm looking forward to this process. I did not get to attend. I don't think a lot of people got to attend, to a certain extent, a little more advertised. And I think you're up for a challenge, because I think there's a little more awareness in this town than there's been the last time you visited. There's a lot of different sides, scopes, things that are added. Actually, I attended a meeting and no one was really sure about the lower end Islington Street last night. And I'm glad to find out that it is part of it. So that definitely is. The northern tier is definitely going to be a challenge for you. As far as what is going on existing, Nick, they're going to be aware basically of everything either in the process going on, what each board is looking at to be able to determine, because what we're going to finish, as far as with what his job is able to go and do, is what we've already pretty much chosen, some of us anyway. Have chosen a direction. So I'm in hopes maybe you might be able to point out maybe a mistake or two. would be kind of helpful to some of the residents that are concerned today and for 10 years from now, 20 years from now. I'm in hopes of something with that, but I'm definitely looking forward to it.
Great.
I'm up for some long days if I have to. Thank you.
Perfect. Thanks, you and Rick. Me both.
I just want to add maybe part of your response, Brian, on the last question. I think it's going to be really important, as we discussed before we started tonight, that there are a number of projects that have come along the pipeline since you left the city 8 months ago. And we look at the Whole Foods project and the hotel conference center as an example. It's now got it's taken shape. It's in front of the Historic District Commission. It's in front of TAC and shortly the Planning Board. These are the kinds of projects I think that you're going to need to become familiar with, because they aren't on the ground, and it's not just those of us that work here in the City Hall that see these projects, and we've seen them for months. I think it's going to be very important for the public to actually see these projects before they're built, because they have been approved. Some of them have made it out of the court system recently and may in fact be under construction in the next year. So as we look at that north end on Claire's question, there's a lot of space out there that'll be very different a year from now or 2 years from now that may not be impacted at all by this process. And therefore, I think the previous speaker, questioner, was wanting to make sure this process is informed by those projects, because they will have a profound impact on the quality and character of the spaces, particularly in the north end. So we need to make sure we get you up to speed from the planning department as to where some of these larger projects are before we get started.
I have no doubt that you will do that.
So Brian, is it Brian?
Yes.
You had suggested that we reach out to the developers of those said projects. So does the city or somebody on your team have a plan to reach out to those people? I don't feel like it's incumbent upon me to reach out to those folks, because I think it would be obviously great to have them involved. Also, side note, I will also do my best to help get a broader constituency out for the charrette. So perfect. We should talk.
Awesome. Yeah.
You know, I think we're going to include that in our outreach program.
Yeah.
We clearly need to get property owners, developers, even some of them that aren't yet here, involved in this process. So we'll take that under advisement, and you're the first one, right? Yeah. 3S Art Space.
Hi.
Hi.
I look at Islington Street or the corridor, and one of the significant aspects of just looking at that map is that there's a really huge amount of open space on Islington Street or in that corridor. And it's abutted by, I think, because I live there, one of the nicest neighborhoods, the neighborhood between Islington Street and Middle, and then continuing over past Middle. And it seems like a lot of this is focused on structures. And I know that that's all private property, but is there any thought of how to create more open space along with the design of structures in this process?
Yes. The idea is that it's just when you said open space, I immediately thought, what kind of open space? And I didn't know if you meant, you know, the parking lots.
Yeah, well, pick and pay parking lot is huge.
Right. Or if you meant
the greenery that I see. Old city yard or the, yeah.
So you didn't mean like parks and green open space, right?
Well, no, but I mean, there certainly could be.
Okay. So, yeah. So when I look at Islington Street especially, you know, I see that too. It just jumps right off the page, especially when you have the context of, you know, downtown right there that's so, you know, sort of built out compactly and all that. And, you know, when we see parking lots and large open, you know, we call that underutilized property. And there are opportunities for things to happen there in very amazing and creative ways where you can take that space that, you know, first you need to see, well, is that parking, you know, being used, and, you know, is there too much? Is it, you know, because it looks, you know, as I've driven down there a couple of times, and it seems like it was industrial in the past, maybe. And so a lot of times, you know, as uses change and industry goes away, they don't need all of that stuff. And so there's some really cool things that you can start to, you know, you start to see lots of like arts districts pop up and those kind of places with these cool industrial buildings. And there's some really neat things you can do. And so, you know, from a planning perspective, when we're looking for opportunities, you know, I don't see very many greenfield opportunities or where nothing's happened and it's just like, you know, farmland or woodland or whatever. You're going to have to start looking for the kind of gray field, if you will, like parking lots and those sorts of things. And so it's at the front of our mind. And so what we'll count on you guys to do, as especially those of you who live, you know, right there, say, you know, I've always thought, you know, it would be great if something happened here and it could transition and really be a value to my neighborhood instead of detracting from my neighborhood and those kinds of things. Those are the discussions we'll have when we're drawing together. But also, and I'm happy to keep answering, you know, any questions you guys have, but also, if you know, as you guys think about it, you know, tell me, you know, what do you think? What do you want to see? Or, you know, is there anything that you're particularly concerned about in some of these? So we can ask questions and do a little visioning while we're here if you guys want. So what do you think? What should happen in parking lots?
Well, I think one of the things that's been happening is that that Portsmouth in general is becoming less pedestrian friendly and more car friendly. And I think that's really clear in the Northern Tier with the new port walk developments and stuff like that. It's, you don't want to walk around down there anymore because the cars are intense. I don't know. I just think that it's healthy for a city to have good pedestrian avenues and ways to facilitate, you know, people getting out of their cars rather than, you know, driving.
Right. Right now, as a resident, as a neighbor there, do you feel comfortable? Are there things you like to walk to in the neighborhood and shops
and
things?
But it's and there's parts of it that are, you know, the sidewalks are inadequate, things like that.
Yeah. So some infrastructure issues that make it less desirable to walk around. You walk from the north end? Yeah. Okay. That's good to know.
Good?
Yeah, I'm good. Maybe. Do people want to hear me?
Yeah, of course.
Okay.
Especially the people at home.
I when I can walk, which is not right now, I walk from the north end downtown on a regular basis, and the only issue I have is that port walk sidewalk has been closed for construction, but that's a temporary thing. Traffic can kind of be intense, but I haven't, just from another point of view, I haven't had an issue making that walk daily. So
that's good. You know, and it's interesting when we hear two different opinions about the same topic, and so then we go, okay, well, we need to go see what that is, you know, and why there are two different points of view, because it usually, you know, if everybody says the same thing about it, it's pretty clear it is, you know, so now we have to go figure out what are the issues that are, you know, making where it's less clear, you know, so.
So, Brian, thank you very much for being here tonight, and also for the people who showed up tonight and the people watching this at home. This is very important, so thanks for being here. We've heard at least tonight three times people saying, how do we get the word out? How do we get people involved and everything? And I'd just like to say that I think that's the responsibility for everyone in this room, everyone in the community, to be able to get the word out for different generations of people. I know that this has a lot to do with the master plan that we're working on, the 10-year master plan that the city is working on. The master plan we did 10 years ago, we had students from the middle school and the high school involved in that. Those students are now 10 years older, and some of them are young adults living in this community. So that's what we want. We want to be able to continue that. So we want to be able to have young people involved, and I appreciate the assistant mayor bringing that up. Jim Swain. So the other issue is people of all ages, as I said, the older people, the seniors in the community who have a lot of value, I feel, and have a lot to offer, have been around the barn a few times, and they've seen a lot of different things. We need to get them to give us their input. So I guess what I would say is that it takes all of us to be able to pull this off. This is very important. This is an opportunity for the city, for you to be involved in what's going to be the future of the city, and have a say, and be able to see this. We encourage everyone to be involved. But thanks for being here.
Yeah, that's good. Yeah, it's tough, you know. It's like planning staff, planning departments, you know, they've got all their other responsibilities, and then we come to town, we want to do this big event, and then they have to turn into a PR department as well, all of a sudden. So it's like, we really do, no kidding, you know, I always tell people, you know, bring three or four or five people with you if we want to have a, you know, where there's standing room only for these things, you know.
Brian, you referred to uses and functions earlier, but more than what we did last time, a lot of these areas abut residential uses. Islington is this combination of districts, mixed residential office, business. So I'm sure as people get into this, they'll be concerned about uses and allowable uses more than we might have been in the downtown area, which, you know, we kind of know what it is. So, and I thought that was a confusing part for all of us conceptually before, to how form and use comes together here. So could you elaborate a little bit more on that? I'm thinking particularly of the Islington Street Corridor, because it must represent every district we currently have in town. Okay. So we know it's challenging, and it's going to be challenging from a use perspective.
Yeah. So the way that we think about it is that if different uses are incompatible forms, or have a compatible character, the use becomes more compatible. Because what you find is, for the most part, especially today, people build buildings that reflect what they're putting in it the day they build it. And so if it's going to be a gas station, it looks like a gas station. If it's going to be a convenience store, it looks like a convenience store. But now what you're seeing is, as has always happened over the years, as has happened all in the downtown and the historic areas, all of these buildings had many, many, many uses, and they just change in and out. And so now what we're seeing is this whole thing where it's adaptive reuse, we call it now. You said there's just like, oh, we're just changing, you know. Now it has a name, and they'll take this gas station. Now the gas station's like this cool bagel shop, and the gas pumps are out, and you can go have outdoor dining underneath the pavilion and all of those things. And so, you know, the gas station's there, the neighbors are there, people are used to it. But in a lot of cases, we'll see where we're thinking about these things, you know, in some of the newer areas, you know, they had the factories and the industry right near the houses, and it was back then no problem. Of course, you know, we need to walk to the factory to work or whatever. Nowadays, people are less tolerant of those sorts of things, and you know, they've become dependent on uses as a way to keep, you know, separate those things. And so what we'll do is we'll focus on, one, we'll look at the uses that are currently allowed, because it's important, you know, to be, really be considerate of, you know, the rights that people currently have on their property. And then, you know, see if there's a way to simplify, consolidate, you know, or expand in certain areas where it makes sense. But also thinking about the transitions from residential to things that are more mixed use. Because I think that, you know, you're right. I mean, everybody's so used to mixed use in the historic areas. But as you get into more clearly detached single family neighborhoods, it starts to be more of a touchy subject. Where we're really challenged is places we go where, you know, they've built an afterthought, you know, 1950s highway, one lot off of a detached single family residential neighborhood. And then we're trying to figure out the uses in there, you can imagine, you know. So hopefully it won't be that bad, but more challenging than downtown. And we'll just work with you guys to figure out, you know, what makes sense.
Hi, I live on the Islington Street corridor, and one of the things that my neighbors and I and my family really like is that it's like its own little village. There's coffee shops there and a couple restaurants, and you can walk to the grocery store. But there's a lot that we would also improve because it's not like the best walkable place, and it could use like a little updating and better use of the land. My question for you is, are you going to use, when you sort of come up with a proposal or an idea or a vision, are you going to use the same zones that are currently, that were adopted for the downtown and just kind of place them along these different areas? Or are you going to come up with separate new ideas and new zones specific to that area?
Yeah. The short answer is I don't know yet. We'll have to see, you know, once we get out there and do our synoptic surveys and measure and see, you know, what's what. You know, I have the sense that, here's what we find in most places. For instance, there's parking lots. You know, when you see something that's, you know, an opportunity site, something, we'll often find people say, you know what, if we're going to have development there, we'd like it to be more like that stuff we love the most over there. And so it makes sense to, you know, if you're transforming. But in other cases, like when we were working in Yarmouth, they had their historic neighborhoods, but they also had their sort of 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s neighborhoods. The overall experience of living in those neighborhoods was relatively the same. The prices were higher in the historic neighborhoods, and there were some elements of character that were different. And so they each had the characteristic 3 designation, which is more detached single-family residential, but they weren't exactly the same, and so we made a distinction between the two. And so, you know, it depends on if we're looking to preserve exactly as it is, or if we're looking to transform, and then also what we find when we get there. So we'll see. But I think that we didn't have a character district 3 in downtown, did we?
No.
So we'll likely be adding one for sure for the detached single family neighborhoods around, at least one. So.
I guess I just had a couple questions about process. So we had, before we had a process where it was 4 days and then we got a report back from you folks and it went through the boards. So I guess I'm a little confused in how come we can't kind of give a timeline for when it might reach City Council because of the process. I mean, I think it really makes a difference on how much time your company would take. But if we could really kind of put a whole timeline together, that might be helpful because I know people are concerned about some development and people are concerned about potential things on Islington Street. So that would be great. The other thing is, if we could have a map of what's been completed, so people can see how much has been completed visually versus just hearing about, because one of the things to answer your question about Islington Street, for Little Chief Street, I mean, I don't know how many of you know where Chief Street is, but there's some small houses on that in the middle of town that has a little zone. And so what I liked about the whole process was is that they could be little zones if need be to meet whatever is required within that area. So to answer what you were asking, in the past we have done that where there's little zones to really look at what is in that neighborhood within the block. So I'll just like to throw that out. But if we could have a visual and if we could have a timeline so that people know from start to finish, especially if we're going to really push getting out there on the web so that people can see the process and where they can jump in and potentially jump out.
Just one follow-up on that. I guess my concern in asking that question was, I think that for a lot of people that live in the Islington Street corridor, it's very transitional, and there are certainly a lot of people that don't want to see that area become kind of like cookie-cutter imitations of what is downtown. Mm-hmm. We'd like to see something a little more representative of the unique architecture in that area.
So that specifically, yeah, go ahead, Nick.
Well, I was going to say that's a really good point. A lot of things were in those questions and statements. We really only had 3 character districts in the 80 acres we looked at downtown. And Esther's correct that there were within the character districts different building heights that would be on a street-by-street basis, which is how Shave Street, for example, is only 2.5 stories, but it's in a district where the heights range from 2.5 stories to 4 stories. So there's a lot of nuance that goes with the character districts, as Brian said, between the new and the old, the tall and the skinny and the wide. Thankfully, all that can be embedded into the code, so you end up with one district with a lot of variation within it, depending on where you are geographically. I think the question about the timeline is appropriate, and I think we clearly are staggering these two charrettes. It's clear the work product for the first one will be prepared prior to the second, so we're likely to see something come before the City Council for the North End prior to Islington Street, because again, we're going to have at least a 2 to 2.5 month lag between the two charrettes in order for these folks to work on the code, bring the code in, and us begin the public review process. So we will put together a general timeline once we map out the two charrette dates and have the second one firmed up. I know there was one more question there.
Architecture, cookie
cutter. Oh, architecture, yeah. In the downtown, obviously, we had a very different context. 75% of all the buildings of the 362 that were in the 80 acres were contributing or focal buildings from a historic preservation standpoint. We don't have anywhere near that looking at these two areas, and everybody knows it. So we developed, as part of the design aspect of the building form, design guidelines that the Historic Commission uses for any new building that comes into that 80 acres on any of the, there's 400 properties and 362 buildings, but we have design guidelines that are pretty homogeneic, if you will, because the context is very, very strong, has a lot of integrity, it's very authentic. That will not be the same, obviously, in the North End or in Islington Street. So one of the challenges we have with this project is whether, in fact, we have any design guidelines for these areas. The Historic District Commission's working on general design guidelines as a separate project for the entire historic district, but there are areas of the Islington Street corridor, like the Frank Jones Center, that are currently outside the historic district. So building design and architecture is something very much on the table for discussion in both of these areas, and I think we're going to have to come to some consensus as to whether this project includes them or not. But it's not, again, predetermined that we'll even go down that road. More questions?
This is for you, Ryan, but it's also for Nick and Rick. To follow up on what Esther said, there has been a lot of discussion about the North End, and we have a lot of development ongoing. For better or for worse, it's going to happen. And so the question becomes, this issue that arose at City Council from Zelita Morgan and others was, let's get a vision for the North End. And as Nick just said, we've got these new design guidelines, and they work really well in, I'll use the South End as an example, where you have a lot of historic buildings. That doesn't exist in the North End because we took them all down. I think the idea of dredging up what it used to look like, it is a good idea, but that's not really, it seems a little false. And so it seems like what's already there is going to play a large role on the design guidelines. We have Portwalk, we have HarborCorp, we have Maplewood, and possibly a garage that the city will build, similar to HarborCorp, for lack of a better example. So the question becomes, how will this vision process that you showed us in Maine, and you previously worked in Burlington, Vermont, how does the vision process work so that you can take the technological new and the historic old and bring them together in harmony and have a really good visionary process? Because if you look at the form-based zoning, it was a fabulous process in terms of form and zoning. But when you talk about character zoning, it really isn't the same thing. And the real question is that there's a real hot debate going on, and there's a lot of mudslinging going on. And it's in part between the old and the young, and it's unfortunate. So the idea of getting the young involved, I think, is terrific. And I think we have to use a visionary process that gets a real input into the process. Some people raised the question of, you know, we've got a lot of city councilors here tonight, and I think they're really going to have an open mind to this and the participative. But I'm not aware there's anybody from the HDC here. One, sorry. The new member. Two. Oh, I forgot. You're the city council representative. The chairman's not here, to be more specific, or the vice chairman. So the question is, how do we make the visionary process work when we raised the North End and took the history out? And the HDC has already concluded that what little remains is Maplewood Avenue is so wide that we don't really care that those little houses in the cemetery remain, because the street's wide, and therefore we can do what we want on the other side. And I'm not trying to, I think this is a great process, and I thought the result last time was wonderful, and I think it's taken us a long ways, but this is a really tricky area of town with a lot of stuff that's gone before. So I think that map, Nick, of what's going to go up, including the potential of a garage, I know that's not certain. And walking with Jim Spillane, he pointed out, standing on the corner where he used to live before it was raised, that if you build that garage where it might go, you're going to have a wall from Christian Shores blocking everything. There'll be a bunch of buildings, and the garage would be the final piece that would block out the view to the North End. So while you can walk it, visually, you're not going to be able to see it. So my question really to you is, how are we going to really have a constructive, visionary process and not a lot of mudslinging between the old and the new?
Well, I think that's why we hired TPUDC to come in and facilitate the process and bring a diverse group of people together and not just have the same old voices in the room. and have these folks that do this daily facilitate a conversation with adults and young adults that can generate consensus and generate not unanimity, I don't think what is what anybody's after. It's a goal, but it's likely not where we're going to end up. I think it's coming to general agreement, and I think there's a lot. I've been working in the city for 3 years, and I think the level of agreement amongst people is much higher than they think. And I think that's what a good facilitator can bring out and get people through a four-day process to understand and listen to each other, learn from each other, and build on the agreement. And there will be disagreements, but I do believe these guys are more than capable, and I've seen it not just here, but I've seen it in other communities. The process can work, and it won't always be easy, but I think
the question for Brian is, how does the visionary process work, which is a little different than what we did last time?
Yeah. When you start incorporating vision in a specific way, where pen meets the paper, and you can see the drawings and renderings, and it's really exciting. And it seems like, from what I hear from you guys, is that so far you've been reacting to proposals that have come before you. And so now, you know, there's the opportunity to, you know, impact as much as you can, as not being the property owner, you know, what happens elsewhere, you know, that's yet to come. One of the things that we have to figure out is, you know, in a lot of the historic places we work, you'll find this idea of not wanting some contrivance of fake historic buildings. And so all things that are new look new. They're modern, they're contemporary, they're, you know, steel and glass and corrugated metal and all of the new things that people like to use these days on, you know, more modern buildings. And what we try to do is make sure that, you know, you see a lot of the problems that were caused after sort of the, you know, World War II and some of the things that happened, the different architectural styles and all that. It's not necessarily that the architectural styles were terrible themselves, it was all of the other things that came with them, the buildings being set back and not addressing the street and blank walls and on and on and on and on. And yes, you know, architectural styles, you know, besides the historic stuff, seem to come and go, and there's fads, and sometimes, you know, we're glad, sometimes we're sad about that fad. And what we'll do is, you know, the form-based or character-based approach is, insofar as you can, without specific historic, you know, historically accurate architectural requirements, you're going to get as much right as is humanly possible with zoning. And as it moves forward, you know, I'll be interested to hear how you guys feel about that. When we're looking at, you know, taking an area that once was industrial and making interesting and new things happen, you know, what is the kind of the aesthetic and the vibe? Because the architectural style, you know, can work towards that. I mean, you know, obviously when you're in an area and, you know, there's, you know, sort of magnificent Corinthian columns and brick and marble and all of these things, and, you know, you feel a certain way. When you go into other areas where you see these, you know, kind of, you know, metal, and, you know, you can imagine flame shooting out anywhere at any moment in a safe way, you feel a different way, you know? And so so we'll talk about what is that we want to infuse in them, because we have this whole thing that we've done. We call artisan light industrial. And the way I say it is cool people making cool things that you'd like to watch them make, but you might not necessarily go into the shop. You might look through the window, they make it, and then they sell it in all the boutiques and shops that all that everybody wants to come visit. You know, so there's all sorts of different things you can think about from a, you know, character perspective, and that does have a certain character to it. So the visionary process is fun, it's exciting, it's liberating. But it's something you have to do carefully, you know, especially in a place like this, because I'll bring my, you know, my rain slicker and my waders, you know, but when mud has been slung, you know, sometimes you get dirty. And so when you're working in sensitive areas like this, where there's lots of emotion and energy, we have to be careful. Like, you know, I can't imagine that it's really going to be helpful for us to show you counter proposals to things that have been approved. Probably not helpful. you know, just confusing and, you know, irritating and all of those sorts of things. So we'll focus on the things that we can impact change on, and, you know, do our best to make sure that it's not only just what you guys want to see, but also it's market driven and it's realistic so that whoever owns the property could actually do it too. And so we take your concerns and your interests and your passions and your hopes and dreams and aspirations and marry it with their hopes and dreams and aspirations and find, as Nick said, that they're not always different. It's just sometimes how it's articulated and how the vision comes out. And if you have the opportunity to talk about it at the beginning instead of, surprise, the bulldozers are here, then it might be, you know, not so necessary to scream at walls. Yes.
I think the participation of us as young adults and young professionals is important, and we will encourage our peers to be here. But I also would challenge you to think about ways that you can involve us other than being here in person. I know some of us are at stages of our careers where we work 10 and 12 hour days. So I would encourage you to think about how our participation in person might not mean ingenuine or not constructive participation, but actually ways that we could provide feedback over conference calls or surveys or video conference, just different things that we could sort of do to change things up and maybe add to the discussion.
Yeah, that's great. Thanks. Actually, you guys do live broadcasting sometimes of these meetings, right? Oh, hello. So we, you know, wouldn't it be kind of cool? We've never done this before. Wouldn't it be kind of cool to do a virtual exercise for those who couldn't come? You know, we make the maps available. You know, you can't come. They'll pick up. You'll pick up the same maps that people are drawing on in the room here, and I'll give the instructions to everybody. And then you guys do your exercise, and then you bring it back and you show us, and we'll note that this was done live via satellite or whatever. It'd be really cool. So, yeah.
I'd like to circle back to the civic spaces. Some of the most important parts of Portsmouth are civic spaces like Prescott Park or Market Square, but virtually all the land is in private hands out Islington Street and in the North End.
Yeah.
So how do you, you know, integrate that into that? Because even small parks, pocket parks like we have in some parts of the downtown, are important, but right now I believe in the downtown where we had the character-based zoning, you have to get to a two-acre site before there's any requirement for the integration of public spaces.
Yeah, so from the visioning side, what we do is we decide where it makes sense, we altogether decide where it makes sense to have open space, where we'd like to see it, and then we draw it there. From a practical side, then you have to decide, are we willing to do what it takes to make that happen? And what that means is, if you don't own the property and it's not city-owned property, then somehow you have to acquire the property. We'll get a little technical here, and we'll say, all right, do a Kickstarter campaign, right? We're going to Kickstarter, we're going to new park, and everybody's going to donate online, you know, and those sorts of things. Or, you know, you guys decide that it's important and you want, you know, to put the tax money forward to, you know, purchase that, to make that civic space. But we start by drawing it and visualizing where it should be, because, you know, I was just having a conversation in Maine about there's a tendency for the municipality, and rightly so, to focus on where they have property currently. It's like, well, we have property here, so we're going to put the city garage over there, not garage parking deck, but where we keep all of our equipment for snow plows and stuff. And, you know, sometimes certain where you have property currently isn't the necessarily where the next thing happens. So planning based on things that are easy to do is not necessarily the way to go always. And so you have to be clever, and sometimes you sell that property that you own over there to get that property over there. You do a land swap, all sorts of complicated things that, you know, drive, you know, everybody who has to make it happen on the city side crazy, I'm sure, in every place, you know, that we work in. But I think that, you know, figuring out where we want to have it and what type of civic space is appropriate, you know, is important. And like you said, I mean, there are requirements, you know, in the character-based coding for that. And, you know, if we might need to evaluate, is that the right acreage size, or, you know, whatever. So we'll work through that with you guys and see what you think.
All right, I think we've got time for just two more quick questions.
Brian, if I could, I live on the corner of Bridge Street in Islington. I'm the last house on the street, right across from Discover Portsmouth. Couple of points, if I could. Number one, long time ago, somebody told me that, and I believe it, that urban renewal actually spreads faster than urban blight. So I'm very encouraged by all that goes on in Portsmouth. It's really, really a wonderful experience. If I could relate one thing that I've noticed, and I think most people will agree, this town gets a good part of its revenue from the tourists that come. We all love to see them come, and we all love to see them go. They pay the taxes, and then they go home. And that's the truth of the matter.
Yeah.
However, here's what I see. I look across the street. They get to the health food store with a map in the hand from Discover Portsmouth. They look right. They look left. They look up Islington. They have a puzzled look on their face. They turn around, and they go back. Mm. Okay? Now, if you want to make a viable neighborhood or something that's really got some life, you got to bring people into it, even if it's just the residents that actually live there. Witness Cafe Kilm. There's people there all the time. Why? Because we know about it, but tourists don't know about this. Okay? The North End is so bereft of parking. It's horrible. We need a parking garage. Now, not everybody will agree with where it should be. I think it should be at Gary's. Now, along with that, and I'll probably lose my head for this.
You're a bold man.
Wouldn't be the first time. I think that we should consider putting a train station there. Imagine the benefits of being able to go from Portland to Boston. Used to be a train station there many years ago. If you're going to have a garage, you can have a train station there too. One more thing. Now that you've got parking in the North End, which is a heck of a lot more than you had before, you take the opportunity to showcase two of the most important buildings in town. Number one, Discover Portsmouth building, which is done in the style of Charles Bulfinch, who designed the Massachusetts Capitol building, and two, which happens to be my house, the Buckminster, which was built in 1720, some years before John Paul Jones's house. I would like to see that parking lot completely turned into a park so that when people get to the corner, they look across the street and see a beautiful park with trees, benches, maybe a fountain, whatever. It would showcase that building, which is so beautiful, Discover Portsmouth. Dare I say, wouldn't it even be wonderful to discontinue Bridge Street along that area, make the park that much bigger? Bridge Street is really useless anyway in that place. Wonderful opportunity to create a small central park. We have nothing when it comes to that. Let's bring people into the corridor we're talking about. Thank you.
Great. Yeah. That's good. So make sure you, when we do the map exercise at the opening presentation of the charrette, that you draw all that. You put all that down. No kidding. That's how it works.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Well, that's good. Has anybody got a last question?
All right. Last
one. Thank you for allowing me a final question. It gets me to wondering with all this discussion, and you've obviously inspired a lot of people, and you're motivating an entire community to get involved in this vision building process. But what I have to wonder about is, with all of the momentum right now of the construction that is already underway and the pressure that is creating as far as more development oncoming, how is this process going to be effectively supported by our city officials in such a way as to be able to provide some counter pressure to all of that, to sort of slow it down, perhaps harness it, get it under control long enough to allow the visions that come out of this process an opportunity to be, one, formulated and then sort of digested and then put out there, as you say, right down to a plan, if you will, designed to paper so that the would-be developers don't just steamroll right over the whole top of this thing. And 2, 3, 5, 10 years down the road, it's sort of like, well, as someone else said earlier, that was a colossal waste of time. Mm-hmm. How does that whole process, how do we get that process under control so, in fact, the vision that we come up with is what ultimately the developers themselves would be excited to be able to come in and make happen?
Yeah. Well, you know, I think that, as Nick pointed out earlier, certain things are going to be, you know, foregone conclusion, and other things will, you know, you'll have, even if they've begun some process, there may be opportunities to influence them, and then yet other things haven't even begun. And so, you know, I've not seen any community say, you know, sorry, those of you who are in the process already and, you know, are you know, sort of officially underway, you have to wait until we're done doing this visioning. You know, a lot of communities don't do the visioning even. And so what I'll say, you know, I'm imagining the first day, you know, most of the time we're going to be, you know, hearing people say, gosh, I'm so upset about this thing. I wish that was involved in this process. And then we'll start. And so I would love it if you guys could actually think those thoughts before you come. And then when we come, we'll save ourselves a day, you know, that first day, so we can really, you know, move that stuff forward, because we can only do what we can only do, all of us together, you know. And and I'd say, you know, focusing on moving everything forward that we can, impacting everything we can, but let's know what we can impact, you know. And so I would say, you know, as Nick's pulling together the map with all the different proposals and stuff, maybe there's a way to let us know which ones are already, you know, too late, and which ones are still available to kind of hear the input and possibly, you know, accept the vision. Now, the thing you have to note too is, just to clarify, the vision, the drawings and stuff, you know, they don't have to do what we draw. You know, the visions are an idea, the thing that you guys can hang your hat on. I don't even know how you guys normally do. Do you guys vote and adopt plans like that, or is it just a plan that's available for people to look at? It just depends on where we are. Yeah. So, you know, what I like to think about is it shows you what you can do. And a lot of times, believe it or not, developers actually would prefer for you to be happy with what they're doing. And so they'll actually say, wow, you know what? This is, they've already said they like this. I'll do this instead of going through all of the stuff that I normally have to go through, even though it's not exactly what I was thinking, or I'll take this at least as a basis and begin to adjust that. And so hopefully, you know, you'll start getting things that are closer to what you'd like to see from day one. And certainly the code makes you well down the road already. So I'd say focus on the things that we can fix and change and move forward and let the things that have come and gone be gone, you know. That's kind of my best advice. It's easier said than done, though, I know. So.
Thank you, Brian. I was just going to add one comment to that aspect of the vision and informing that 40% of the land that's out there in the North End that potentially is at risk, because I think that's part of your question, is what do we do with the 40% that's out there that potentially could come in and vest their rights while this visioning process is underway and then the code development after it. We're really talking about 6 weeks from now having the framework of a vision completed. That's not very long to get this 4-day charrette accomplished by the second week of November.
Yeah, the plans will be the vision plan, the drawings you saw. These are all done that week, and we'll do it while we're here. So right. When we're done, you have it.
So that doesn't mean we've got a code in 6 weeks,
right?
But it means the vision can begin to be marketed from the community to the property owners. That's a blink of an eye these days when it comes to how fast things move through the permit review or development review process. And then I suspect within 6 or 8 weeks of completing that vision plan, we'll be starting to look at the first version of the code as a community, which is going to ensconce and translate the vision into the code. So it's really not that far from our present day that we're going to be looking at the vision and looking at a draft code that will begin to, you know, be able to be communicated to the owners that haven't yet submitted plans. let alone inform some of the ones that are in the permitting process and not complete in front of the HDC or the planning board, which hopefully can augment their current designs to reflect the vision. So what I'm hearing out of the session here, three main points for us, other than making sure everyone knows it's at the new Connie Bean at the middle school from November 10th to 13th. That's really important. Spread the word. Outreach is obviously of critical importance across the demographic groups in the community. I think we're going to develop a timeline with an agenda, not only for the charrette, but talk about when this vision plan will be completed and when the code will be expected to be submitted for the first draft. We will also create detailed agendas so people know before they get there which events are going on within the four-day charrette that they might want to participate because it's important that one knows. One doesn't have to be at all 4 days, 8 to 10 hours a day, to plug into this process. And I think Brian's already made that clear. But people can come and go, and there's no harm in missing half a day or a day in the process. Did I get that right, Brian?
Yeah. It's for you guys. The more you can come, the better, of course. And there'll be a prize at the end for the person who participated the most. Last time, Claire won.
All right. So thanks, everybody, for coming. We'll see you on the 10th at the middle school.
Thank you, guys.